This is Dimitri Lascaris reporting for The Real News from COP21 in Paris. I'm here today with Anthony Hobley, the CEO of Carbon Tracker. Thank you for joining us today.
Oh, it's a pleasure. I'm happy to talk to you.
And could you tell me a little bit about Carbon Tracker and what its mission is and and the role it plays in terms of assessing risk for investors in the fossil fuel sector?
No, sure. So Carbon Tracker, we're a not-for-profit think tank. We focus on the energy sector. I think the very unique thing about Carbon Tracker is we're all ex-financial market professionals. So until 2 years ago, I was a partner at the global law firm Norton Rose Fulbright. Our founder, Mark Campanali, built some of the biggest SRI funds through asset managers like Henderson's and Jupiter in the City of London. And probably the biggest component of Carbon Tracker is we now have a team of seven or so former investment bank analysts from the, you know, careers at HSBC, Citigroup, Deutsche, Barclays, etc. Our vision is that we want a climate secure global energy system, but our particular mission, our contribution to that, is aligning capital market or financial market risk with climate risk. And the tools that we use is investment grade financial analysis and regulatory analysis, and obviously translating those things into easily understandable terms that, that resonate in the financial market.
As I understand it, the analysis of the Institute and other analyses that have been done of the reserves the known reserves of the top fossil fuels companies suggest that those reserves are something on the order of five times in excess of what we can safely burn in order to remain within the 2 degrees Celsius limit. Is that correct?
Well, we took a key bit of the climate science, the carbon budget. So the carbon budget tells us that approximately we can put about 2,000 gigatons of carbon dioxide equivalent into the atmosphere by reference to pre-industrial levels. But above that, if we go above that, we are going to go above the 2 degrees, which is the level that's been, that scientists tell us has been politically agreed as a safe level of climate change. Now the problem is, since pre-industrial times, we've already used well over half of that budget. So we have around approximately 900 gigatons left. But if you look at the world's oil, gas and coal reserves and resources out to 2050, you find, as you say, that there's many times the amount of carbon locked up in those reserves than we can safely put into the atmosphere. So if all of those reserves and resources out to 2050 are burned, we will put in excess of 2,000 more gigatons, 3,000 or so gigatons into the atmosphere.
And the scientific community has estimated what degree of warming that would precipitate, has it not?
Well, yes. I mean, if we put all the oil, gas and coal reserves, I mean, we would go above 2 degrees. We may go as high as 6 degrees. So we clearly cannot burn it all. And there's also probability at play here. So we simplified it. So that if we're willing to live with a 50% chance of keeping below 2 degrees, we can maybe use up to one third of the known reserves and resources out to 2050. If we want to play safer and we want an 80% chance of staying below 2 degrees, we can only use around 20% of the known, you know, oil, gas and coal reserves and resources. Now, think about that in terms of risk. I mean, imagine if you got on an aeroplane and they said, well, you know, there's a 50% chance you'll get there safely. Or, you know, there's an 80% chance you'll get there safely, but there's a 20% chance we're going to crash. Would you get on that aeroplane?
And the extent to which the reserves must be left in the ground in order to remain within the 2 degrees Celsius limit varies according to the type of fossil fuels we're talking about. Because, for example, coal generates far more CO2, the burning of coal, than conventional oil, as I understand. Is that fair?
Well, certainly coal, they're two different. I think we need to differentiate between two different uses. Oil is predominantly used for transport in the internal combustion engine. Oil is actually quite dirty when it's burned to produce electricity. When you're comparing coal, it's probably more normal to compare coal with gas if you're burning it to produce electricity. And clearly, gas, you know, we think, although there is an element of doubt here, but we think that gas is considerably less carbon intensive than coal. The doubt for gas relates to the fugitive emissions and all of the associated emissions from extracting and transporting the gas. And I think the jury is still out as to whether those fugitive emissions, you know, would make gas as carbon intensive as coal. So the industry still has some work to do to, I think, address that perception of that issue.
And has your institute or others looked specifically at what proportion of the reserves of companies in the tar sand sector, some of us call them oil sands, I call them tar sands, would have to remain in the ground in order for us, for example, to have a 50% chance of remaining within the 2 degrees Celsius limit?
Well, when we looked at oil, we looked at all the oils, all the oil projects in the world and the oil supplies, all the reserves and resources, and we put them on we created something called a carbon supply cost curve. So we took the cost curve, which is sort of workhorse of the financial markets, but we combined it with carbon intensity. So we said, okay, well, let's look at every single oil project in the world that's on the industry databases and look at the break-even prices of those projects and the carbon intensity of those projects. And what we found at the top end of the cost curve, there's a high correlation between the carbon intensity and the cost. And what you find with tar sands or oil sands projects is they're, one, they're carbon intensive, and two, they're most of them are extremely expensive. So they make neither climate nor financial sense. So, you know, we do not think we need the vast majority of the tar sands projects and, you know, within the 2 degrees pathway. So,
you say vast majority, could you be a little bit more precise?
There may be a few small projects that are already in production, but the vast majority of the tar sands, you know, we do not need. We do not need to open up more tar sands and more tar sands supply.
And so looking at the current valuations of companies like Canadian Natural Resources, Suncor, Canadian Oil Sands, companies that are really focused on the tar sands and don't have a diversified portfolio of fossil fuel assets, is it fair to say that the market is not properly valuing those corporations?
Well, I think increasingly the market is beginning to see this risk. And as we know, with the low oil price environment we're currently in, you know, the markets have adjusted considerably. And I think certainly, you know, in the last 18 months, the markets have got better at understanding the risk of companies exposed to high cost projects, and particularly companies that, I guess, to a degree are one trick ponies. You know, they're almost 100% or, you know, a vast majority of their portfolio is exposed to high cost projects like tar sands. And I think the market is, you know, actually is already punishing those companies. Perhaps there's still more risk that they need to understand. I mean, we look at all of the world's oil, gas and coal projects, and particularly when we look at, say, the oil projects, we would sort of evaluate them by reference to their entire portfolio and how exposed they are through their portfolio to these high carbon, high cost projects. And of course, if you're a company and you know, the vast majority of your portfolio is tar sands, then you are heavily exposed to high cost, high carbon intensive projects. And we would say that means you have a much higher risk as a company. And it's very difficult to understand how you would change that business model to be part of the low carbon transition. Whereas, you know, if you are a major with a much broader spread in your portfolio, there may be things you can do. You can start to, you know, cut from your portfolio these types of high cost, high carbon projects. And we're already seeing that a number of major, you know, global oil and gas companies have already started doing that with tar sands. We've seen, you know, they've already started doing that with Arctic. I mean, Shell and Statoil in recent months have announced they're pulling out of Arctic projects and simply with ultra deep sea projects, all of which are high cost and, you know, in our view, don't make climate sense as well.
And you attended the other day, as did I, a presentation by Michael Bloomberg and Mark Carney.
Yes.
Or an official announcement of the appointment of a task force, a FASB tax, that's a Financial Accounting Standards Board task force, to look at disclosure of climate risk by oil and gas or fossil fuel corporations. And apparently the task force is going to try to develop common standards for disclosure. But I, as a lawyer, and you are a lawyer as well, found it curious that there was any need for such a task force at all, because companies already have a disclosure requirement to reveal to the public on a timely basis all material risks.
Yes.
Whether of a climate-related nature or otherwise. And if companies are in fact complying with that obligation, do we really need a task force? And if they're not complying with that obligation, and I'd like to hear from you on that, why aren't regulators taking action against them to ensure compliance?
Well, I mean,
I think that's a very important question.
But I think the fact
that, you know, the governor of the Bank of England is at a climate summit, I think this is the first climate summit where the governor of a major central bank has attended. And the fact that he's here also in his capacity as chair of the Financial Stability Board is an incredibly important message. Now, the announcement is not a SASB task force, it's a Financial Stability Board task force, albeit Michael Bloomberg, who's been appointed chair of this task force, also chairs the SASB board. So there's obviously a correlation, and probably an important correlation. I actually think you're right. I mean, it's always been our view in Carbon Tracker that the existing obligations on disclosure around financial risk should encompass climate risk and the extent to which that creates a financial risk. And our, you know, Carbon Tracker's analysis is all about showing that financial risk arising from climate risk. But I think there's a lot of work, there's a lot of capacity building and work to do educating the financial regulators and the relevant and the financial professionals that help prepare these disclosures that this is a financial risk and that it's a financial risk that's relevant today, not next year or in 5 years' time. So I agree with you. I think the underlying legislation and obligations are there. We just, there's a quite a degree of education and capacity building to get those applied properly in relation to financial risk arising from climate risk.
Right. And one last question, following on this this topic of disclosure obligations, existing disclosure obligations. Last year, I believe it was, or very recently, ExxonMobil voluntarily undertook to major institutional investors to address climate risk in its disclosure documents. And I'm paraphrasing here, but ultimately what it disclosed after having undertook to do so was the world isn't really going to change. Again, very much this is my own language, but essentially the message was the world isn't going to change and we're not going to have to strand a material portion of our assets.
Yeah.
And this task force, as I understand it, is going to be developing voluntary standards. In light of the Exxon experience and the quality of disclosure you're seeing in the fossil fuels industry today, do you really think a voluntary regime is likely to materially improve disclosure?
Well, if we can get agreement around it, I think it could improve it. But again, you know, I agree with you that we need to ensure that the existing obligations on disclosing financial risk are properly applied. But I think it could actually help in terms of this capacity building and education. Now, that disclosure by Exxon was a result of a letter that Carbon Tracker, working with Ceres, CDP and the Investor Groups on Climate Change, put together and wrote to the 45 top fossil fuel companies. And most of them responded to that letter. But yes, you know, one of the most famous responses, as you point out, is the one from Exxon, where it was, well, you know, we don't believe governments are going to act and we'll be able to sell all of our products. It was, you know, very much a sort of a blight on all your houses type response. And they may be well ruin that. I mean, as you know, with the Attorney General's investigation, the New York State Attorney General's investigation now, then perhaps maybe wishing they had taken a slightly more responsible approach to that letter. And some other companies did. And it's worth looking at some of the responses. I mean, Shell's was a little bit better, but there was still a massive cognitive dissonance. At least Shell clearly acknowledged the problem in the science, but then went on to say, but we're not going to deal with that to the second half of the century, which of course would be too late. But there were some good responses from some other companies from the 45 that were written to it. It's worth looking at all of those.
Well, thank you very much for your time, Anthony.
Pleasure.
And this is Dimitri Lascaris for The Real News.